So if you've stumbled across this video, then most likely you know that Apple's WWDC Worldwide Developer Conference for 2020 is pretty much wrapping up, and it was a virtual show. And we've got to say, man, they've upped the game in terms of virtual show presentation and quality. You've got to give it to Apple. So as you'll hear, Ben from Lover of Tech, let's do a WWDC 2020 highlights on the areas and the things that they announced, because there were some things that were very interesting and some decent amount of plot twists in there. Let's go. Now, first on the list is iOS 14. Yes, as predicted, the next version of iOS is called iOS 14. Most likely it's gonna come later on down the line when is the new iPhone that comes out for this year, and it will trickle down to all the iPhones that can run it. First thing is home screen. So something about the home screen now finally gets an update. And yes, there is an element that is playing catch up. And the first thing that we're talking about in terms of organizing, right? App library. What this pretty much does by the looks of it is auto organizes all your pages on your home screen in a very nice and cohesive way. You've got things like categories, suggestions, and a much more powerful search robustness to it, which finally is good. You know, the home screen's not had much love apart from the, you know, the jiggle mode that we've known for a while and folders. So this is good, right? You know, the whole idea behind it is muscle memory. You have muscle memory for like your first few pages, then all of a sudden you forget all the stuff that's on the other pages. So this is good. And also you can organize what pages show so you can get even quicker access to the app library, which I like. It looks decent. It's something that they're playing catch up, but this is with Apple's touch, and you know how Apple do, they've got to do it that way. Next is widgets. Now on the today screen, we've had widgets for a while, but finally more widgets have been put now onto the home screen. And obviously what Apple was saying is this is more beautiful, more data rich, with again different sizes. Finally, Apple, you're doing it right. This is something that we've been asking for, more access and customization to make the home screen look like how you want to use it. And again, you can drag the widgets from the today screen onto the home screen. Looks very cohesive. It's pretty much self-explanatory, and again, a nice looking UI from Apple's side. It looks good. They've done it finally, and I think a lot of people are going to be happy to have this level of customization, because again, widgets are just a smaller version of your full app. And again, you can have widgets of, let's just say, something like WhatsApp or all the different apps that you have there that supports it. So it's finally good to see widgets on the home screen. Next is the support for picture in picture. Now again, you can watch video in picture in picture mode. Yep, cueing all the Android boys, even myself, that have been saying we've been able to do this for a while depending on what software skin and Android that we're using. But again, finally, Apple, from what you had before, you've put it onto iOS. We're happy to see it. It's good to see it. You can use picture in picture as they demonstrated, and you saw it looked sleek, and it was nice to be able to see that you can do it. And it's really growing the multitasking capability of iOS while you're using other apps and watching video. And again, I liked what I saw when it came to swiping to the side while it's off screen. You see a nice little tag arrow there, and the audio still plays. Or again, you can bring it back to full screen. This is a nice way. Again, picture in picture is nothing that we've not seen before, but it's good to see Apple finally implement it in their direction and in their own flavor and their way. Next is Siri. So yeah, Siri, we all know how smart or not Siri is. Whether you like it or not, that's Apple's proprietary voice assistant that you use in iOS. And again, they've made the design much more compact and streamlined, because in the past, when you commanded Siri to come up, it would take up the whole screen. Not very intuitive. They've made it more compact, more streamlined, much faster. And it's something that doesn't take up the whole screen, as stated before. So again, Siri's design and looks, everything is all about streamlining and polishing the look and how things behave on screen with the UI, which is great to see. Next is Messages. Messages, we know that's a very popular app when it comes to things like iMessages and messages in general. And again, streamlining. They've made it much more cohesive. And I like this feature. You're able to pin your favorite conversations to the top so that you know you've got access to, because you know how it is sometimes, man. It's there dedicated to show you the latest messages that you get coming straight to your screen. So sometimes when you're scrolling through, you miss it. And I have that on WhatsApp when I use it. So it's good that you can pin your favorite conversations to the top so you've got access to them. There's obviously more customization when it comes to things with designs, with Memoji, whoever uses Memoji, emoji if you still use it, of course. And you've got redesigned group conversations. And for example, when you get notified and a mention, it comes up, you've got inline replies. Man, inline replies, where you can reply to specific messages. Finally, there are some messages. Again, I'm not an iOS user. I've not been an iOS user since the iPhone XS Max for a while. So this is kind of refreshing to see that they're looking at what other popular messaging apps do and bringing it in. And obviously you can have specific mentions of people in your chats as well, which is great to see. Visually, they've done a couple of upgrades where you can have a visual representation of avatars and emojis for your groups. And also when someone messages, you can see their emoji or their avatar come up, so you know that it's them that's talking. So good to see finer refinements to messages in iOS. Good to see it. Is there. Next is car key. And as someone that really likes cars and technology that surrounds cars, especially with consumer electronics that we use, something as personal as our smartphones, car key looks really cool. So what we're basically saying is that you can leave your key at home. You've got an electronic car key built into your phone that works with specific cars that support it. And what they were demonstrating with the new 2021 BMW 5 Series, where basically you can leave your key at home, it uses NFC to tap to unlock, and you can pretty much place your phone into the charging pad and use the push button start to go. Crazy stuff. But what was really nice is that you can actually share keys and give full access or restricted access to other people. And again, restricted access is more for your teens or your younger drivers that aren't going to be as responsible, because again, 2021 BMW 5 Series, that's a big boy car. So to have that level of flexibility and to share keys with, you know, people that you're sharing it with and stuff, that's kind of slick in a way. So if you ever forget your keys and whatnot, man, and also there's an element of privacy and protection that comes with it, that's really, really good. So car keys seems to be something that I could see popping off quite well. App Store. So we all know what App Store is for iOS, the revolutionary place where you pretty much have an app for everything that you want to do. But again, with how big the App Store is, discovery and having an easy, cohesive selection of different apps that you know of, and especially that you don't know of, is something that Apple were talking about. In comes App Clips. Literally, they're small part of apps to your main ones. They're light, they're small, they're fast. App Clips can pretty much work integrated with your Apple Pay, and it uses, you know, QR codes to scan. It pretty much looks like a slick way of having a much quicker access, and they demonstrated it with different things, like whether it's, you know, parking meters, whether it's using a bike that you're hiring out. You know, they made a joke about, hey, potentially there might be app clips for things like ice cream and other different places. So I think Apple really want to spread this out. And again, it's all about flexing the power of their App Store and what they've been able to achieve with it for all those years, all the way back to the iPhone 3G days. Next is iPad OS 14, and pretty much taking cues from all the things that they've been doing in iOS 14, again, from a redesign, a new home screen where you can put widgets on there that's much more compact and much more sleeker and gives you information on the home screen, not just in the today screen, which is great to see. And it's gonna be even much more optimized for the canvas and the screen that is on iPad OS. The photo apps also has had a redesign, much easier browsing when it comes to zooming in, zooming out to see all your apps, with a new sidebar as well. So again, they really demonstrate it well, but in a way, we'll see more of it once we see it in the public beta and we have it hands-on and you get a full review of it on the products that we have in beta, and also full, especially when the new iPhones come out, man. That's where the biggest showcase is gonna be. Also a redesign to the music app, and you can see you've got full screen player, a nice UI, utilizing the size of the iPad and the iPad OS. Again, to be expected with Apple making everything look nicer, much more cohesive, and again, much more streamlined. Siri, yep, same compact, new design that's coming, so that it's much more sleek and streamlined, and also redesigned to the phone app as well, where the whole notification taking up the whole screen was so intrusive. So much more smaller, much more compact, doesn't take up the whole screen when you get incoming call. Again, it's the little things, they're stringing it together, making it much more streamlined. Next is search, faster and much more robust across the whole OS, being universal across everything and every app, including web searches. So again, makes it much easier to literally not have to open specific apps or specific areas. You know, you could just search for what you want to search, and it will know based on the search engine that's in there and how it's interlinked with the iOS system, to really do what it needs to do, which is really good. Makes it much faster, much easier to get on. Apple Pencil. So Apple Pencil has had some decent upgrades. So for all you Apple Pencil lovers that love to scribble and also express yourself, they've done some nice upgrades. And some of the upgrades are Scribble and Convert to Text, which I think is clutch. So if you enjoy using it, and I know people love using Apple Pencil, it's a great accessory from what I know with the iPad Pros. You've got much better hand recognition as well, and also better spatial awareness with different objects on the screen, whether it's drawings, whether it's handwritings, whether it's text, so that it knows which one you're selecting and you can have a much more seamless experience. I think even for people that don't do artistic stuff, this might make even note-taking and doing things like with your to-do list, whether it's scripting or any kind of thing with the Apple Pencil, even better. So I'd love to see it. Again, the verdict's out. We'll have to see it to see what it comes out and how good it is. Next is AirPods Pro, and the sound quality that comes from them, they were not messing about. Spatial audio recognition and simulation. So what Apple are doing is they're using advanced spatial audio recognition algorithms for them to be able to simulate surround experience on the AirPods Pro. And this is crazy. Like, how do we even simulating it and showing it and demonstrating it, man? It will support in things all the way up to surround standards such as Dolby Atmos. And it's not just about creating that sound simulation, especially with two earbuds, which they were stating is quite difficult, but it's also a case of knowing how to use the gyros to keep the spatial sound recognition very consistent. So even when you turn your head or you turn your device, whether it's your iPad, your iPhone, you know, whether you're on a bus and the direction changes and whatnot, it's able to keep it consistent. And I mean, again, this is adding more value to the AirPod line with auto switching. And now this for the Pro, this is now making it a truly pro pair of earbuds. And I think people that invested are going to be very happy that they had this. Next is watchOS. And I'm going to glance over watchOS quickly, but it's not because there wasn't anything important. Again, updates, things like compilations where you have more information on the screen, but with less intrusiveness. Again, it's all about making the information that you see on the screen much more accessible, much more streamlined. You've got face sharing as well, which again, you can basically share your favorite watch faces that you like with your contacts on social media, with the community, vice versa. Again, making it more fun to have your Apple Watch when you're using it. Again, another new one, Dance Workout has been added to it. So you can use Dance for tracking your fitness, different dance routines. It's something that they added, making it much more valuable. But sleep tracking, I think sleep tracking is very important. And they've added features such as what they were calling wind down, where it will help you prepare for bed to have a good night's sleep. From things like putting your devices into do not disturb mode, your favorite calm sounds, and also having a nice and easy subtle tactic vibration to your hand when you're waking up to make it much more subtle and less intrusive. So that's a really good one. But one thing I did really like, and especially for the current situation that we're in, auto detection when you're hand washing. And this is crazy, man. It will use gyroscopes, as they were saying, to detect the motion of hand movement when you're washing your hands, and also use the mics and audio to listen out to the sound of water and actually put a counter so that you're making sure that you're washing your hands properly and for the correct length of time. And when you're done, gives you a nice little haptic touch. And that's something that is, I think, is kind of cool. Simple, subtle. I'd love to see it, see how the consistency, we'll see how it works, but that's something that they've added onto it as well. Now macOS. So the new name for macOS. Yeah, macOS Big Sur. Okay, that's the name. So away from the name, you have a new design as expected. Again, new dock design with new app icons. Everything is all about upping the UI, making it much more streamlined and cohesive. That's something that Apple like to do. So we're showing off things like the Finder app, being more compact, much more refined. Again, Mail app, same thing in terms of design, the accessibility. Photos app having much more easier transitions, faster, smoother for zooming in so you can see all your pictures and your library. It said the menu bar is translucent again, but Control Center finally comes to macOS, something that iOS and iPad users have been very accustomed to. And it's great. You can toggle things like, you know, dark mode being on and off, changing the brightness on your screen, and also now grouped notifications. So Notification Center finally has group notifications, much more streamlined and cohesive. We love to see it. And things like having widgets and improved messages, maps being improved. But for me, man, the biggest one is the biggest plot twist. Again, don't know if you guys remember when Apple back in the day transitioned from PowerPCs over to the Intel-based silicon. That was a big deal, very, very big deal. It upped Apple's compatibility and so much more accessibility for not just the performance of their native apps, but also third party. And they're doing it again. They're transitioning to their own Apple silicon. Wow, that's a big deal. And macOS with Apple silicon, what they're basically saying that they're using Xcode, which is obviously used to make all Apple apps, the native ones, work straight away with Apple silicon. And that's including their professional apps. Like, we're talking about Final Cut Pro 10 working on Apple ARM silicon. That is crazy. And they're using things like Universal 2 to work with third-party apps and apps such as Adobe Creative Cloud, Microsoft Office, etc., all working on Apple silicon. They're going in. They're putting in work to make sure that the progress of this is a fast transition and it's working with all the apps that we know and love. They were even showing it working with Adobe Creative Cloud with Photoshop, right? And that looked crazy. And even then, showing it working with Final Cut X again, jury's out. We need to see how it performs to the normal processes that we're used to having now. But they assured things like the update to Rosetta 2, where it translates apps that run on Apple ARM as usual, like as if they were on your normal Intel-based processors. macOS as well, now having apps that work with iPad and iPhone apps. This is a big deal. This is a big deal. And they were even showing a developer transition kit that looked pretty much in the shape of a Mac Mini. And, you know, now that you're going to be able to run iPhone and iPad apps, what does that mean for the future? Does that basically mean that eventually, you know, we might get touchscreen MacBook Pros? I hope so. Because, yes, as much as they've made it easy to transition all these iPad and iPhone apps onto macOS, these apps were built with touch in mind. And I hope Apple bring touchscreen MacBooks, please. I'd love to see it. But, you know, that's one of the things that I'm thinking about. What is going to be the development, man? So it's going to be interesting to see how that transitions. We still didn't get to see a true split screen multitasking on iOS. It depends. I know some people are like, we don't really use it. It's great to see picture in picture, but I would have loved to see a true split screen on iOS. We'll probably see more as time develops, especially when you're going into beta and especially when the new iPhones come out later on during the year. So that is pretty much the key parts of the roundup to WWDC, Worldwide Developer Conference for 2020. I've got to give it to Apple, man. They have upped the standards of virtual conferencing. It looked on point. Like, anyone that actually didn't agree with how good it looked, I don't know what conference you're watching, but personally, that's a new gold standard, man. That's some dope stuff that I was watching. Again, the jury's out. I'd love to see all these developments, you know, reviewed once the products are available for it. And yeah, if you liked more roundup content like this, again, Ben from Lover of Tech, you know what to do. Hit that subscribe button, hit that notification bell so you're part of Team TLS, the Tech Lover Squad. And also like, share, and make sure you're subscribed. And I hope you guys are safe during this time. I'll catch you in the next one. Peace.